Okay. Well, I'm delighted to introduce to you Liberty Church Youth Community Group, and they are going to share with us a special Christmas presentation. Let's give them a round of applause.
Good morning, church. We are the Liberty Youth, so we are here to present a Christmas play for you guys. Over 2,000 years ago, God sent his angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin called Mary, who was pledged to marry a carpenter named Joseph.
Greetings, Mary. You are highly favored, and the Lord is with you.
What do you want? Why have you come to see me?
Do not be afraid. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will call him Jesus.
How is that possible? I am a virgin.
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the Holy One to be born will be the Son of God.
I serve the Lord. May His will be done.
Joseph, Mary betrothed, found Mary was pregnant before they came together because he loved her. Yet he believed he's been unfaithful. He decided to divorce her quietly so that she could not be disgraced. But before he could, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream.
David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife. Her child was conceived from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that census should be taken in entire Roman world. Everyone was required to go to their hometown to register. So Joseph took Mary, who was great with child, on a hard journey to Bethlehem to register. When they arrived there, they looked for a place to stay.
What do you want?
There are no rooms left. Can't you see the city is crowded? There's a stable nearby. You guys can stay there.
The time soon came for the baby to be born. Mary gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloth and placed him in a manger.
Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven, na 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 na.
Messed it up.
And there were shepherds living out in the field nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. They were terrified.
Guys, do not be afraid.
Who are you? Why are you here? Go away.
I bring you great news that will make great joy to all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born. He is the King, the Messiah. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby lying in a manger, wrapped in clothes.
Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared in an angel, praising God, saying, "Glory to the God in the highest heaven, and the earth peace to those who favors rest." So the shepherd hired off. Away in the manger, not creep for a bed, but little Lord Jesus laid out his sweet head. I love you, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stand by my side until morning is high. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judah in the days of King Herod, behold, there the wise men from the east.
Who has been born King of Jews?
We saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him.
King Herod had no intention. King Herod heard about the wise men and their baby who was called the King of Jews, and he was disturbed. He called the wise men secretly to him.
Hey, you, come here. Come here closer. I am your king, and I demand you guys to go ahead and find me the baby. By the time when you find the baby, I want you guys to show me where he is so that I may go and worship him. I command you, hurry up right now.
King Herod had no intention of worshiping the baby. Jealousy and fear deep in his heart. He planned to kill the child, but the wise men went on their way and followed the stars. They have come until they stopped over the place where the child was. They saw the child and his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him.
We are wise men, astrologers from the east. We have traveled a long way, guided by a bright star, to come and bring your child gifts. I have brought the gift of gold.
And I have brought the child the gift of frankness.
And I, one of the wise men, and I have brought the child the gift of myrrh.
Thank you for these gifts. May God bless you and keep you safe on your journeys.
King Herod asked us to return to him so he can come and see your child, but we were warned in a dream not to go back to him.
We shall return to our country by another route.
This was the first Christmas after the wise men have grown. An angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, told him to escape to Egypt. There the Holy Family lived until King Herod was dead, and they went and lived in a town called Nazareth. Jesus grew in wisdom and stature in favor of God and men. He was the Son of God, born to bear our people's sins.
hiyo wakati.
Awesome. Let's give them another round of applause. I particularly loved that remixed version of Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Up until today, I'm still trying to figure out what the word hark means. But yeah, thank you so much, Victor, for helping put that together. I know that working with such a vibrant group of young people comes with these challenges, but that was a wonderful Christmas presentation. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, it's my honor now, and it really is a privilege. I know I say it all the time, and it may begin to get old, but it never gets old to me. I am now going to invite my mom, whom some of you call as my mother-in-law, but she's mom to me, and she's going to preach the word of God for us this morning. Let's give her a round of applause as she comes.
Morning, Liberty Church Manzini, and all those joining us on Facebook. Well, there's so much to thank God for this morning, so much to celebrate. You know, look at that. The youth have already done the preaching. You know, it gives me so much joy. Not all of us growing up had some people in our lives to help us minister the word of God at a young age. So, Liberty Church Manzini youth leaders, well done. May God bless you. And yes. And we pray that, you know, the youth who are, not only are they ministering God's word to us in such a creative way, but they are being generous with their time. You know, they could be playing or doing a lot of other things, but they come to church to build themselves up in the Lord, and they come to do God's word, and they give of their talent. Did you see the talent, the creativity, even in the music? So we pray that, you know, the parable of the talents, where the servant who made the most was given a double portion, we declare that blessing upon our youth in Jesus' name. Well, thank you also to the praise and worship team. Wow, you know, Ingobile, Ingwenyama Kajuda. I don't know what you could be going through, but I really feel that victory that the Lion of Judah has conquered whatever could be a challenge in our lives, in our situations. Thank you, praise and worship team. Thank you for all the teams serving so that we are here this morning just in God's presence. I am Make Chasusa. I serve as an elder here at Liberty Church Manzini. And this morning, I'm privileged and delighted to share the third message in the series, Draw Near, Awakening to the Wonder of God with Us. God is with us, as the youth showed us. And as we know, we are looking forward to celebrating how God came to be with us with the birth of Jesus Christ. So, in this series, the first message was preached by Babe Chasusa, and that was Draw Near to Hope. And the second message was preached by Pastor Lu, and that was Draw Near to Peace. The title of this message, of this morning's message, is Draw Near to Joy. So today's message is Draw Near to Joy. Thank you, all of you, for being here this morning. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we come before you with thanksgiving in our hearts. We praise you, Lord. We worship you. We love you, Lord. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for forgiving us. Thank you for hearing us when we pray and meeting us at the point of need. This morning, Lord, we pray, we ask that you help us to humble ourselves in your presence and to humble ourselves always so that we would receive the hope, the peace, and the joy that you have for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen. Joy to the world. Joy to the world may be a familiar carol, but it's something many struggle to experience this time of year. It is a familiar carol. We sing it often. Some of us have been singing it since we were little children. But it's something many still struggle to experience this time of year. During a time that celebrates holiday cheer, while many secretly suffer with feelings of depression, sadness, and loneliness, we can struggle to know how to experience a sense of happiness. You know, how do we experience this sense of happiness, which is supposed to come with this joy, when all around us we see so much depression, we see so much loneliness, and so much more. But when a group of wise men set out on a journey to find Jesus, they soon discover an overwhelming joy. An overwhelming joy. One we can experience this season as well. So this morning, I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 to 12 as our main text for this message. Matthew chapter 2, verse 1 to 12, and I'm reading from the NIV version. It reads, Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod. About that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him. King Herod was deeply disturbed when he heard this, as was everyone in Jerusalem. He called a meeting of the leading priests and teachers of religious law and asked, where is the Messiah supposed to be born? In Bethlehem, in Judea, they said, for this is what the prophet wrote. And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not least among the ruling cities of Judah, for a ruler will come from you who will be the shepherd for my people Israel. Then Herod called for a private meeting with the wise men. and he learned from them the time when the star first appeared. Then he told them, go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. And when you find him, come back and tell me so that I can go and worship him too. After this interview, the wise men went their way. And the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. I'll just repeat that. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered the house and saw the child with his mother, Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasure chests and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. When it was time to leave, they returned to their own country by another route, for God had warned them in a dream not to return to Herod. And we just saw the wise men in person, isn't it, in the youth presentation. So, verse 10 says, when they saw the star, they were filled with joy. And our message today is drawing near to joy. So, my brothers and sisters, everybody listening, my hope this morning as we listen to this message is that we can all be filled with this overwhelming joy. It was not just for the wise men. That overwhelming joy is still there and it's for all of us. So this overwhelming joy stated in verse 10 is the joy that the Lord has for each one of us. So as I stated earlier, you know, there is so much going on that looks like cannot be a source of joy in spite of the fact that we are in this season of celebration. So we could be asking ourselves, how do we become filled with this overwhelming joy? When looking around us, there's so much that can cause us not to feel the happiness that should come with this joy. The good news is that, yes, we can actually be filled with joy. In spite of the things that could cause unhappiness, we can be filled with this joy that was filled, which filled the wise men when they went to see the king. In order for us to be filled with this joy, it is important to take note of something that will help us realize that we can be filled with this joy. And that is to realize that there is a difference between joy and happiness. Yes, there are a number of things that make us feel unhappy, but there is a difference between joy and happiness. I'll briefly talk about happiness. Happiness can be seen as a result of what happens. Usually we feel happy because of what has happened. We feel happy if we are in agreement with what is happening. You know, if the decisions being made are things that we agree with, if what we see happening in people's lives, in our workplaces, in our church, we feel happy. If the situation we are in our lives, is what we are expecting, we feel happy. So what happens can make us feel happy. But if we don't agree with what is happening, we can also feel unhappy. If we don't like what is being said to us or what we are being made to do, or if we don't like some of the choices that are being made that affect us, we can feel unhappy. So happiness is a result of what happens, what happened, what is going to happen, or what happens. And of course, looking around us, sometimes circumstances can cause us to lose any happiness we might have had. We can become troubled, disappointed. We can become angry, discouraged, and sometimes even bitter because we are not in agreement with what is going on. Whether we feel what we don't agree with is someone's fault or responsibility, or whether it's a result of our own mistake or it is our own responsibility. I'm sure most of us, if not all of us, have experienced moments of unhappiness when we are not in agreement with what is going on. Now, I would like to talk about joy, this overwhelming joy. You know, I can't help smiling at the thought of this joy because of what I've just discovered about it. Joy, on the other hand, is a deeper experience, that we experienced in our hearts. And it is also a way of life. It is not something just which is just a result of something that is happening. And we are going to find out more why joy is a deeper experience. Now, I hope we are beginning to get that there's a difference between happiness and joy, and having more hope that we can indeed receive this joy. Before I say more about what this joy is and how we can receive it, I would like to encourage us all, that as we celebrate the birth of our Savior, like the Sunday school showed us last Sunday, and the youth have shown us today, you know, as we sing joy to the world, let us awaken to the wonder of God with us and prepare our hearts to be filled with this joy. You know, we have to take that step. The joy is there for us, but we have to take that step to receive that joy. God desires that each and every one of us, and all the people that we minister to, all the people that are in our lives, would receive this joy. So let us prepare our hearts. Let us draw near to God to receive this joy. God sent his only begotten Son, our Lord and Savior, whom we are celebrating in this season, to die for us, to die for our sins, so that we could receive this overwhelming joy. So let us not miss out on it. I'm going to highlight some points to help us receive this joy and understand it better, why this joy is different from the happiness that is as a result of what happens. The first point I'm going to highlight is that joy comes from being with Jesus and following his ways. Joy comes from being with Jesus and following his ways. John 15, chapter 9 to 11, NIV says, as the Father, this is our Lord Jesus speaking when he was on earth, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. So, I would like to ask us a question. If we are not filled with this joy this time, do we have him? Do we have Jesus Christ in our hearts? We don't have to put up our hands or anything, but it is something for reflection because he promised that joy. So if we have him, we should have it. If we don't have it, we can receive him and have it. Let's reflect on that. So, brothers and sisters, you know, some of you are my children, even my grandchildren. I am encouraging you again to open up your hearts and set yourself up to receive this joy. If you feel you had it and you are not sure whether you have it, it's there. It's for you to be reassured once again that you have it. So that was the first point. Joy comes from being with Jesus and following his ways. Let's ask ourselves, are we with Jesus? Are we following his ways? The second point I would like to highlight is that this joy, the joy that God gives, cannot be stolen from us. You know, in a world where it looks like it can be so easy for something to be stolen from you, you know, something that is yours, you deserve it, you worked hard for it, you need it, and for no reason, it can be stolen from you. You know, the world that we live in, we have to be so security conscious to see that things are not stolen from us. Isn't it wonderful to know that there are things that cannot be stolen from us? There are things that we cannot lose, and the joy of the Lord is one of them. The joy God gives cannot be stolen from us. I'm going to read from the book of James, chapter 1, from verse 2 to 4. I'm reading from the NIV version. James 1, 2 to 4 says, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything." Romans chapter 12, verse 12 says, "Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer." I'll ask another question. Do you feel as if you are being robbed, or you were robbed, or you've been robbed of your joy? Could it be by a person who came into your life? Could it be by people? Could it be a situation? Could it be something where you feel it's your fault? You made a mistake. How could you do that? Or could it be something which maybe others did and you feel, how could they have done that? And you feel that your joy has been lost or you are losing it. The good news is that you cannot lose that joy. The joy that God gives us cannot be stolen from us. We cannot lose it. As James chapter 1, 2, 4 says, and as Romans 12, 12 says, let us persevere and remain in Christ. Whether it's affliction, whether it's injustice, whatever it is that is making you feel like you are losing your job, whether it is relationships, family relationships, friend relationships, your joy still belongs to you. You still have it. Persevere in Christ. Don't make decisions that will take you away from Christ, but continue to obey his commands. When trials and afflictions come our way, let us continue to walk in faith. Stay faithful. And you know what will be the end result when we persevere and stay faithful? We become mature as children of God. We become more and more like Christ, and that is not all. The verse promises us that we will not lack anything. How many of us feel like we lack so much in our lives? But when we persevere, stay faithful, obey God's commands, even in affliction, even when we think the world is against us, we shall become more and more like Christ. And we shall lack nothing. We shall be content in our walk, in this race that we are running in life. There's another point, the third point. Our joy invites others to seek Jesus. I mean, just imagine the way we are all seated here. Okay, we have our masks. It's not easy to see who's joyful and who is not. But imagine if, as we are seated here, someone who has never been to church, probably they don't even know much about Christianity, walks into a place and all they see is a lack of joy. They sit in the service and they really can't see any joy in the place. I think it would be very difficult for them to want to come back. And I'm not talking about necessarily that they should find us laughing, but we can sense when joy is lacking in a place. So our joy invites others to seek Jesus. When people see the joy in your life, your family members see the joy, whatever you are going through, whether you've lost your job, whether you have experienced trouble, but your family members, your workmates, see that you are not losing your joy. You are still treating them with respect. You are still treating them fairly. You are not taking out your anger on them. You still have your joy. They wonder why, and they will know that it's because you have Jesus Christ in you, and they are likely to want what you have. Even when you speak to them, they will believe you that what you have is something that they would also like to have. So this joy was given to us so that it can help us also invite others to seek Jesus. There's the scripture in John 1, verse 4 to 5 tells us, I'm not going to read the scripture, but we can read it at another time. John 1, 4 to 5 tells us about how Philip, after Philip had become a disciple, had started following Jesus, looked for Nathanael, told Nathanael about Jesus. Nathanael also became a disciple. Obviously, he must have been telling Nathanael with a lot of joy. And even now, I mean, when you think of how Christianity started and when you think of where it is now, I think one of the things that has drawn people to Christ is the joy that people see in those who have Christ in them and are obeying his commands. So when we have Christ in us, we have faith in Christ, it brings us salvation that results in unspeakable joy. Joy is not something that we are going to get anywhere else. Joy is only found in Christ when we receive salvation. The salvation results in unspeakable joy. Joy that we cannot describe. Joy that we cannot explain. And no matter what happens in this dark world, we can experience light and spread joy to those around us. You know, there have been times that I've met people who are so joyful, and after getting to know them after a while, I cannot believe how rough their road has been. You know, they would have had so much to complain about. They've gone through so much. But they have maintained their joy because of the hope that they have in Christ. So, let us be those who are going to abide in Christ so that we are filled with this overwhelming joy. Even in the darkness, our overwhelming joy will spread out to others. Let us be those who will daily rejoice in the Lord. The scripture says, rejoice in the Lord always. Let us be those who are going to spread out that joy. It doesn't matter what your role is at your workplace, whether you are the CEO, whether you are the youngest, or whether you are the one who is receiving people who are coming in. It doesn't matter. You can be the one to spread that joy. It doesn't matter whether in your family you are go-go, and maybe you feel you are out of touch with the younger ones, or maybe you are still very young, or maybe you are a teenager and everyone is expecting you to be problematic. You can be the one to prove them wrong, and they will ask, but why is this teenager not living according to our text? Why isn't she troubling us? Why isn't he troubling us? You tell them it's because you have Christ in you. and all you have is joy. Galatians 5, chapter 22, I'm reading from the New Living Translation, says, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, and faithfulness. So Christ in us, the Holy Spirit in us, will produce that joy, not necessarily what is happening. Actually, many times you find that this joy, this overwhelming joy in us, will affect the things that are happening. So instead of us waiting to see happiness as a result of what is happening, we are the ones who are going to make happiness come, because we already have that joy and we are spreading it out to others, and we are causing circumstances and situations which could be otherwise be unhappy become situations filled with joy. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16 and 18 says, rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you. Drawing near to joy. At this moment, I would like to talk to any of us who by this time, in spite of watching the youth presentation, in spite of listening to the messages in this series, drawing near to peace, drawing near to hope, and today, drawing near to joy, you're still wondering, you know, you still don't see how you can really have it. So how do I get Jesus into my heart? How do I have the Holy Spirit? You know, it's possible to be in that situation. Or maybe you could be someone who is saying, I've been hearing this message so many times, but I don't really think I have this joy. Somehow I've missed it. You know, yes, I believe in God. Or maybe I've been going to church. I went to Sunday school and, you know, I went to youth and so on. But I really don't feel that connection. You know, I really don't feel Christ, the Holy Spirit in me, giving me that joy. I would like to tell you that there's no need for you to miss out on that joy. Jesus Christ, whom we are celebrating, who was born in a manger, did not stay in the manger. There came a time when he went to the cross and paid a high price because of his love for you and me. And that price that he paid for you was for your salvation, for my salvation. So let us not reject that powerful, wonderful, needed gift from Jesus Christ. We need it because it's the only way for us to be reconciled to our Creator. So, I'm talking to someone, in short, who has not received salvation, who has not at any time felt that you gave your life to Jesus, invited Jesus Christ into your life as Lord and Savior. If you have not, all of us at one time had not yet done that, but most of us now have. So this could be your chance to give your life to Jesus, to ask Jesus Christ into your life as your Lord and Savior, a joyful, joyful moment. Do not harden your heart. Do not harden your heart. I encourage you, if you'd like to give your life to Jesus Christ, do not wait. We don't know what tomorrow may bring. We don't even know what the next minute or next hour will bring. Only God knows the future. So do not waste your time. Do not harden your heart. Now, I'll ask all of us so that we support anyone, if there's anyone here who would like to give their life to Jesus. And also, in a state of prayer, when we close our eyes and bow down, we should be praying so that anyone who needs to give their life to Jesus would do so. We just don't close our eyes for no reason, but we close in prayer, standing in the gap. We want people to come with us to heaven. We want to depopulate hell. We want everyone to come to heaven. So let us pray. So we are going to close our eyes, and we are going to bow down. And if you are here and you say, today is the day, I'm giving my life to Jesus, you raise your hand as a way of humbling yourself before the Lord and surrendering, and for your own self to know, that day I raised my hand. So we are going to bow our heads, close our eyes, and if you are listening on Facebook, you can also raise your hand. God will see that hand. Let us close our eyes. And if you are here, you want to give your life to Jesus, please raise your hand high. Okay, do not hesitate. If you want to give your life to Jesus, please raise your hand high. All right, we are going to pray. If there's anyone who would like to give their life to Jesus, we are going to pray with them, and everybody will repeat this prayer, because it's necessary that we believe in our hearts and confess with our mouths. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus Christ to die for my sins. I receive him today as my Lord and my Savior. I believe in him with my heart, and I confess him as my Lord and my Savior with my mouth. Lord Jesus, thank you. Walk with me. Help me. Let me experience eternal life with you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Thank you very much, everyone. If you gave your life to Jesus and you are on Facebook, please send us a message, send us a comment. If you are here, you might have raised your hand or not, or maybe you thought about it later and you didn't raise your hand, but in your heart you want to give your life to Jesus, please visit either the prayer table or the next step table outside for someone to help you. I'll talk to another group of people, and these are people who, in spite of what was said in the message, if you still feel that somehow something has robbed you of your joy, not only do I want to reassure you according to the scriptures that you cannot be robbed of that joy cannot be robbed of you, but I would like to pray with you. You don't have to raise up your hand, but in your heart, receive the blessing. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that when we receive salvation, the joy of the Lord is our strength. We receive this joy, and it cannot be robbed from us. We cannot lose it. I pray, Almighty God, that we will not be deceived into thinking that we do not have the joy in our lives, but we shall continue to rejoice even when it looks like we are going through situations that would rob us of the happiness. I pray, Almighty God, that through affliction, through trials, through difficult situations, would maintain this joy. And not only would we maintain it, but would rejoice always. Would rejoice in singing praise to you, and would rejoice in spreading your word. Would rejoice in giving hope in this lost world. Would rejoice in prayer. Heavenly Father, may this revelation come to anyone who feels that they have lost their joy or their joy has been robbed from them. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. All right. At this moment, I would like us to just declare, all of us, you know, as a way of really receiving the joy of the Lord that has been given to us, that cannot be robbed from us. I would like us to declare Psalm 28, verse 7. It's not on the screen, but I would like that you please say it after me, because we are saying it in agreement. You know, we are agreeing together, and it is remaining with us. Psalm 28, verse 7. I would also urge you to say this, if you don't already do it, say it as often as you can, maybe as soon as you get up in the morning and before you go to bed. The Lord is my strength and shield. I trust him with all my heart. He helps me, and my heart is filled with joy. I burst out in songs of thanksgiving. Have a very blessed Sunday, church, and a blessed season of celebrating the birth of our Savior. Don't lose that joy.
Praise the Lord. For the sake of those who don't know me, but for those who know me, the one who was preaching was my wife, so I don't know what one says after his wife has preached. All I can say is that you sense that God is speaking to us, is using us, and all we need to do is to be available to be used by the Lord. Shall we give Makesha Susa a round of applause? The way the order of service was done today was that I'm the one sharing the offering message or message of encouragement. So that's why I've come up here soon after.
And here at Liberty Church, it's our mission.
Before
Follow
I
Jesus, thrive.
Give us the usual directions, can we turn our attention to the screen for a video message?
And here at Liberty Church, it's our mission. Follow Jesus, thriving community, and make a difference together. And one of the ways that we make a difference is through a special offering we bring once a year called the Legacy Offering. Legacy Offering runs throughout the month of December, and it's an opportunity to give over and above our tithes to support missions, outreach, and church planting. Now, our theme this year is together. And we're believing to make a difference together in three key areas: global missions, moving forward, and kingdom impact. In this video, I want to share some of the powerful ways that God is moving in his church and how your financial partnership through the Legacy Offering can help us to take new ground, serve our communities, and plant new churches. Now, these inspiring projects and partners are all about moving forward. As you might know, Liberty Church Manzini recently put a down payment on the property that our community center and our church there has been renting. And this year's Legacy Offering will help us begin to pay down the remaining balance. You know, Lou and Zinti are doing an extraordinary job, and they have so much vision for the difference that ownership is going to make there.
Yeah, we are excited to have begun this process of purchasing a property for Liberty Church Manzini. Mm. And the first difference that it's going to make is that it's going to help us put a stake in the ground.
Yeah.
And it will communicate not only to those who are a part of the church right now, but those who are considering being a part of the church, that we are not just passing through this city, we are a part of the fabric of this society.
Yeah.
You know, it will communicate that we are not just in Manzini, we are for Manzini. And that's something that I really feel will help us grow in ownership, not just of the building, but in ownership of the vision.
Yeah, and we're also really, really excited about the opportunity to go from just improvising in a place that wasn't our own to tailor making this property for the needs of the things that God has called us to do. You know, during the week, we have many different kinds of things going on, from the after school program for kids to trainings that different organizations are doing. And on weekends, we have our Sunday service, we have Liberty Kids, even community groups use the building. And so now we're going to be able to tailor make it and have it be fit for the things that we actually get to do in the building.
Awesome, I love that. And finally, the other difference that owning land and owning a property is going to make is it's going to take us much closer towards being sustainable.
Yeah.
It's going to help us in that journey towards sustainability to bring us that much closer. And we're looking forward to getting to that place where we can not only take care of our needs, but begin to also invest in taking care of the needs of others, whether it's church planters or it's central office, however the Lord allows and empowers us to do. We are looking forward to the difference that owning this property is going to make.
You know, as well as the extraordinary opportunities there in Manzini, we're also planting our next Liberty Church community in Washington Heights in New York City, as well as sowing finance into brand new church plants in Germany, in Italy, in the Congo, and four cities across the United States. You can learn more about these and other moving forward initiatives at libertychurch.com/legacy offering. And we'll also be sharing more about opportunities to partner for greater kingdom impact in the weeks ahead in the coming videos. You know, there are several ways that you can give. You can use the special envelopes provided at our Sunday services. You can give via EFT and label it Legacy Offering, or you can give online at libertychurch.com/give and choose Legacy Offering from the drop-down menu. All giving needs to be received by December 31st. And remember, this is a special offering over and above our tithe, which is used for the day-to-day operations of the church. So let's all commit to giving generously and making a difference together.
That video, just in case you are overwhelmed with the information there, for you and me as Liberty Church, so our legacy offering, actually you can as well see it as the one we are calling for a city. So this is what will happen for the other communities. What they offer for a city, they will, it will come towards us or with the other needs. But for us as Liberty Church Manzini, our legacy offering can as well be the same as the for a city. So when you see the envelopes, any of those two, you are doing the same thing. Like I said, I'm here to share the offering encouragement. They will display the ways to give. Now, each time we prepare our hearts to worship God through our offering, remember that God is looking at our hearts. Again, from the songs, from the message. I mean, I can't help this teaching about the heart. So the ways of giving are there. We highlight this every time. But I would like to share something. I like to tell stories, but the stories are meant to illustrate something. Again, I don't want to draw attention to myself, but to help you. I'll be 69 in 2 months' time. So I've seen different ways of giving, like you give through, you know, a plate is passed around, right? Now we have a way where we are dropping off the giving in the box. Then there are all these ways which are given here. Now, when I was young, when I was 16, I took it that unless you give your offering in the basket, God hasn't received it. Now God is saying you can give it through mobile money. At another stage, when I was older, you know, so like you have 10 kwacha, so I was in Zambia, you have 10 rand. So when the basket is passing, you want to give 5. So you put in 10, then you see if there's a 5 in the basket, in the plate you take. And now I don't know how you guys are getting your change, because we don't want the... we don't open that, you see. And by the way, that came about because later on we discovered that, well, there may be one or two people who would then take from the plate. So why am I giving this story? It doesn't matter how you do it, whether you put your offering in that box, Momo, God is looking at your heart. That's the point of my sharing this story. He's looking at your heart. So let's prepare our hearts. That's what God is asking. It's so simple. Prepare your heart. So otherwise I could come here and show that, well, Babesha Susa looks like he is the one he gives, or he gives his tithe. No. It's God who see my heart. That's very important, brothers and sisters. That's the message for us this morning. That's the reminder. Shall we pray? Lord God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that all that we have comes from you. Thank you for the gift of life. thank you for the jobs we have. I thank you, Lord, right now on myself that I'm standing here in front of these people. Thank you, Lord, that I can give. I pray that all of us, Lord, will give because we are worshiping you. We are saying thank you for what you have done for us. And Lord, you have told us in your word that you love a cheerful giver and that you will bless us, that you will meet our needs. We receive, Lord, from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's turn our attention to the screen for announcements, for church news.
Hi, I'm Nicole Smithy, the Director of Teaching here at Liberty. Advent is just around the corner, and on November 28th, we as a church will be celebrating the Advent season with a new series called Draw Near, Awakening to the Wonder of God with Us. Throughout the series, we will be offering a daily Advent devotional on the Liberty Church app. Each day, you can watch a video with a specific scripture and reflection for the day, all on our app. So to access these daily devotionals beginning Sunday, November 28th, download the Liberty Church app from the App Store. It's easy, it's free, and by simply opening the app each day, you'll receive a new devotional to help you draw closer to Jesus during this holiday season.
Hello, church. My name is Edson, and together with my wife, Tynette, we serve as prayer team coaches here at Liberty Church, Manzini. 1 Timothy 2, verse 2 says, I urge you, first of all, to pray for all people. Ask God to help them intercede on their behalf and give thanks for them. Liberty Church Manzini has a prayer team that is committed to standing with you in prayer on Sundays and throughout the week. We would love to know what needs you have, what you are thanking God for, and what you are believing God for. Please let us know by filling out a prayer request card before, during, or after the service. We'll pray with you on Sunday morning and throughout the week. The prayer request cards are on the prayer table right outside the entrance to the church.
We look forward to standing with you in prayer and rejoicing together as God answers our prayers on Sundays and throughout the week. As Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 to 7 says, don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand.
Lord, is it just me or mom and dad make a wonderful team? Let's give them a round of applause for leading us this morning. Thank you, mom, for the message on joy. It is different from happiness. Amen. It really is. You know, as she was talking, a story came to my mind that I heard about 5 or 6 years ago. There's this lady who the husband is the one who was sharing the story, and you are saying, my wife is the most joyful person that I know. She's so joyful that even after she got cancer, and because of that, she had to have something that's called a double mastectomy. I hope I'm saying it right, but she had both her breasts removed because of the cancer. when she goes to bed in the night, she says, thank you Jesus, I thank you for the day. And when she wakes up in the morning, she says, Lord, thank you, this is the day that you have made. This is someone who has gone through cancer, gone through chemo, lost their hair, lost both their breasts, and somehow is still able to be joyful. So I resonated with what you said, Mom, about that. Our joy cannot be stolen from us. Amen. I mean, sometimes we can accidentally give it away, but we can quickly take it back. But our joy can never be stolen from us. So thank you. And I hope this Christmas you experience joy. Amen. More than just happiness, I hope you experience not just the happiness of drinking Coke or eating biscuits. I hope you experience the joy of being able to sleep at night knowing that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Amen. Awesome. And Zinti and I also wanted to just say thank you for the gift. We received a wonderfully generous gift last week, Sunday. Completely unexpected, but very, very appropriate for our season. We went immediately and we began to use all of our gifts. We are those kinds of people. We don't wait until tomorrow. By the time the day was out, all of the gifts were in use. And I want to thank everybody who contributed to that gift. And I want you to know that it is something that really, really blessed us. It's going to take a very long time for it to not be at the front of our memory. May God richly reward your generosity. Amen. Amen. All right, and then two quick reminders as we round off the service. We are continuing to say goodbye to Julie. We are thankful that she was able to come to church one more time, but I believe after today she's going to have traveled. So Julie was here for the very first, not the second, she was here for the very first Liberty Church gathering. There was 12 of us. It was me, Zinti, Babecha Susa, Magecha Susa, Peter. I remember a few other people. I'm missing some. But Julie and Ellie were there right at the beginning. And they've continued to be a blessing to us. So we get to continue to say goodbye to them. So even if you haven't known them for a long time, please can I ask you to stop by and bless Julie and Ellie as they head back to the States in this season. Amen. And to Julie and Ellie, I just want you to know that we love you guys. You are a part of the fabric of this community. And even while you're on the other side of this small pond that we call the sea, I want you to know that you always remain in our hearts. Ellie is also my keyboard student, so I'm going to make sure that she continues to be faithful on that side of things. But yeah, we love you guys, and we really are going to miss you. We're going to miss what you guys contribute in this church. And Bibi and Sambulo are traveling. They might actually be in the air right now, but they should be landing soon in America. Sambulo told Zinti that he heard that a haircut in America is $25. So the day before they flew out, he went to get a haircut. And I was like, there's no way he's going to pay $25 for a haircut. I was like, this is a good man. This man knows how to take care of his family. Nobody in Liberty should be paying $25 for a haircut. But yeah, we'll miss them. They'll be back in the new year. And you can feel free to reach out and bless and encourage them while they are back in the States. It's going to be a very new experience for Sambulo. I know when I went to the States for the first time, it was a little overwhelming. People expected me to be excited, but I'm telling you, there were some things that were just a bit more than I could imagine. I would ask for a pizza, and I would ask for regular pizza, but it would come and it would be bigger than our large. I'm like, all right, let me ask for a small, and the small is still so big. But all that to just say that the world out there is a little different to what it is here, and even the things that are a blessing can be a bit of a shock. So pray with them, bless them, and we look forward to welcoming them back soon. Then finally, this afternoon, we are playing soccer. I'm not sure this team is going to win, Babecha Susa. Magecha Susa, was there joy in that? So we need to try again, huh? This afternoon we are playing soccer. And we'd love not only for the soccer players to come, but for those who love and support them, whether it's family, it's friends, you know, girlfriends, boyfriends, many relationships can start there. If you are single, it's ripe ground for getting things moving. But yeah, I would love to just continue to fellowship and enjoy. If you are unable to come, you know, you can support us from afar. But that's another extension of what we call community groups. And you are all welcome to be a part. It's right here at St. Teresa's, so you can even walk there. And we are playing against a team that we are familiar with. And so we want to make sure that we beat them. Huh? When we go to the soccer field, we want to win. So make sure you come. Huh? Awesome. Guys, thank you so much for coming to church today. It's a hot day. I know it is. You know, staying awake, it takes discipline. And for you to be in church on Sunday morning is something that not only we appreciate, but God honors. So as you conclude, I would love to speak the blessing over you that Maggie Shasusa encouraged us in today. Why don't you close your eyes and bow your head and just open your heart, maybe even open your hands as a physical expression of you receiving this blessing that comes from the Lord as you go into your week this week. The Lord is your strength. The Lord of heaven's armies is your shield. May he bless you with the faith to trust him. May he bless you with the heart to obey him. This week, as you go about your day, may you receive help from the Lord. May you receive ideas from the throne room of heaven. May your heart be filled with joy. In Jesus' name, amen. We love you guys, and I want you to know, I never knew I was going to be a pastor. When I was young and they asked me what you'd like to do, Lungile, the first thing was a doctor, second thing was a musician. There were many things that I wanted to, but the Lord called me to be a pastor. This is what I want you to know. I love doing this. And when I see you, my heart, I can't explain. The best I could do sometimes is just cry. That's how dear you are to me. And so I want you to know that you are someone who is very, very dear to me. And I'm delighted I got to see you today. May God richly bless you this week. We're dismissed.